chapter 5. So verse 6, we ended Sunday school with this morning, and it just really hit me. And it says, for while we were still weak, and there was a version that was read that said, still utterly hopeless. At the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Amen. That is such a powerful, powerful verse. If you just want to stand up on your feet this morning, we're going to open up with How Great Thou Art. And what an amazing song. I love, we're going to sing verse 3. When I think that God, his son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. And I just want us to really just enter in and worship this morning, because we have a great God who is worthy of our praises. Amen. Amen. hands to heaven this morning. God, let us become more aware of your presence, Lord. God, help us to focus our hearts on you, Jesus. Lord, let your Holy Spirit just fill this place, oh God. Fill this place and fill our hearts, Jesus. God, we worship you this morning, Lord. Forgive us, God, for letting our minds be preoccupied and for every other thing to take your place, Jesus. You gave it all for us, God. Help us to focus our hearts and our minds on you, Jesus. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. You are welcome here this morning, Jesus. We worship you and we exalt you, God. Great is your love for us, Lord. How deep your love is for us, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
I just thank you for your forgiveness, for your grace and your mercy, Lord.
Yes.
I thank you, Lord, for forgiving a sinner like me, Lord. It was my sin that held you there, God.
Thank you, God.
Held you upon that cross, Lord. I thank you for the sacrifice that you made for us, Lord. And I thank you for that new covenant that we learned about this morning in Sunday school, Lord. I thank you about it. I thank you for it, Lord. And I thank you for all the blessings that you give us, God. You're so good to us. Lord, help us not to get distracted by those valleys that we go through in life, Lord. And help us to remember, Lord, the joy of our salvation this morning. Father, I just pray that your Holy Spirit will move upon this place like it's never moved before, God. and that our hearts will be open for it, Lord. We will accept you, Lord. We will hear the words that you have laid on Dave's heart this morning, Lord, and that our minds will be renewed this morning. Lord, as the ushers come, I just pray that, Lord, that we will give with a cheerful heart. Lord, that you will bless that offering, God, that you will use it in a mighty way, Father. Lord, we love you and we praise you and we give you all the glory, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Welcome to Antioch Church. We're so glad you're here this morning. If this is your first time visiting with us, we ask that you please take this opportunity to fill out the visitor's card, which can be found in the back of the chair in front of you. When this card is completed, you can either put it in the offering basket as it goes by or in the basket on the table on your way out. Let's take a look at what's coming up. September Deacon of the Month is Hans Carter. Youth group meets tonight here at the church at 5:30 p.m. This is for students in grades 7 through 12. Our Awana clubs also meet tonight at 5:30 p.m. This is for children ages 3 years to 6th grade. You can now give securely online at www.givetoantioch.org. Please see your bulletin for further details. Mark your calendars, October 10th through the 12th, you'll need to schedule your picture to be taken for our new picture church directories. If you are available to help volunteer on these days, please contact the church office. Be sure to download our new church app. It's available on Google Play for Android and in the App Store for the iPhone. Our next Loaves and Fishes meal will be here at the church on Saturday, September the 24th. Volunteers are always welcome. Ladies Bible Study will meet here at the church Tuesday, September the 27th at 7 p.m. All ladies are welcome to attend. Our tent service kicks off this week down by the river. On Thursday through Saturday, service will begin at 7 and on Sunday at 10 a.m. You won't want to miss it. Mark your calendars. Lots of volunteers will be needed for our fall festival. We are planning this for Saturday, October the 29th from 5:30 to 8:30 here at the church. There will be a personal finance class kicking off Sunday, October the 2nd at 7 p.m. here at the church. Well, that's everything. We're so glad you're here and we hope that you enjoy the service.
All right. Good morning, everybody. How's everybody doing this morning? Blessed. Good. Good. You're looking good. I don't know. I hadn't looked up at you yet. Yeah, you're looking good. All right. We can bring the lights up in the back, brother. I want to highlight just a couple of things. First and foremost, we have got an awesome week planned here for the church here at Antioch. How many are excited for the tent service? We are anticipating God showing up and moving in a mighty way. And in the last 2 years, I can say from experience, they have been phenomenal. They've been awesome. God has shown up in a big way. We're going to have some other speakers. We're going to have Brother Greg Miller from Wesley's Chapel is going to be preaching Friday night. I'll kick it off Thursday. He'll preach Friday. We're going to have Miss Stacy Fincham. She's a youth pastor from Fredericksburg. She spoke last year at the Warrior event. Was anybody at the Warrior event last year? She is awesome, anointed, powerful speaker. And so every teenager, every young person, every old person you know, bring them out. And then Sunday, to date, we've got 14 baptisms happening Sunday. We can praise God for that. We're going to have three baby dedications also. And then I don't know if you remember this little jar of sand here. We started this last year. We're going to have all the new members that have joined since last year. They're going to be adding their sand to this, and I think we're going to fill it up. Amen? So it's pretty cool. This is just symbolic of the fact that we're all woven together in the family of God. Amen? So come on out. And if even if services are going to start at 7, but even if you're going to be a little bit late, that's okay. I know it's going to be okay Thursday night because it's going to be wild. I'm going to be preaching. And you know I'm going to be preaching. So if you show up at 7:30, 8 o'clock, you'll still hear half the message. Amen. So that's good to know. So, but it doesn't matter what time you roll in. We're going to be there. We're going to have fun. We're going to have hot dogs Saturday night. And, of course, we're going to have a big barbecue lunch Sunday. So it's going to be awesome, awesome time. If you will, open your Bible to Psalm 73. And before we get into this, this is going to be a tough one for me this morning. Before we get into this, I want to remind everyone also, Sunday, October 2nd is a big Sunday. Not only are we kicking off the financial, personal finance class, you need to sign up for that through the church office. Please fill those spots up. We don't want anybody to miss out. And we're also relaunching the 18 to 25-year-old Sunday school class, calling it Emerge. Brother Bruce and his wife, Lauren, are going to be leading that. Trix and his wife are going to be a part of that also. And Hans Carter and Miss Judy Carter are going to be teaching that. And that's a key time in life where a lot of people fall out of the church. We don't want to see that happen here. We want to see those young adults built up in the faith, amen, and going into the world and making their mark. So praise the Lord for that. This morning I want to preach on living in the valley. And for those of you who don't know what a valley is, the valleys in life are those moments when you feel like you are at the bottom. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Living in the valley is there these moments in our life when it seems like everything around us is going wrong. It's those moments in life where it seems like no matter what we try to do, no matter what we try to accomplish, no matter how right we try to live, everything still seems to go wrong. It's the place of struggle in our Christian life, and every believer will struggle with this in your faith journey. You will go through moments where you feel like you're in the valley. And my word of encouragement and exhortation to you this morning is when you're going through the valley, don't forget what it felt like when you were on top of the mountain. Life is full of valleys. And I love this psalm because Asaph, the writer, he is a priest. He's a worship leader in Israel. And he's going through this struggle where it seems like to him, everyone who is living wickedly is prospering. He's going through this season in his life where he knows he has to get up and proclaim the goodness of God and sing about the goodness of God, but he doesn't feel it in his life. He knows that God is good, but everything in his life is pointing the other direction. Does anybody in the room relate to that? Why do the righteous suffer and the wicked prosper? Why am I experiencing such conflict and depression? It seems like the more I try to do right, the more goes wrong. And this is the season that we as a family personally have been walking through. I can tell you the last 2 weeks in our life have been some of the hardest weeks that we've had to walk through as a family, my wife and I. And I don't share, I'm going to be a little transparent this morning. I'm not sharing it with you because I want your pity. It's not what it's about. I want you to know that when I stand up, sometimes when I stand up here and preach, I'm giving the Lord the sacrifice of praise. And not every moment in the Christian life is going to be a happy moment. Not every moment in the Christian life is going to be rainbows and butterflies and unicorns. You're going to have times in life where you are walking through the darkest moments and you're dealing with the depths of your soul. And I want you to know this morning that there's a lily in the valley. We serve a God that when we're walking through those moments, whether we realize it or not, He's carrying us. He's faithful and He's good. This song is such an honest reflection that gives us real comfort on how to live in victory through the valley. And I have this picture because I thought this picture was worth 1,000 words. I don't have any other PowerPoint this morning. This is it. This is where I feel like my life has been for the last 2 weeks. Anybody ever felt like that? Yeah. Where you always feel like you're just looking up. We had stuff go wrong with our house in Orange. We had to put out a lot of money to pay a lot of bills, dealing with a lot of things. And 2 weeks ago, we experienced our 7th lost pregnancy. And I had to stand up here two Sunday mornings ago, and I'm preaching the word of God, and I'm thinking in my heart, God, I know this is true, but I don't even feel it right now. Last Sunday morning, when I stood up here on this stage, and I was singing Blessed Be the Name of the Lord. It was one of the hardest songs I've ever sang in my life. But you know what? I knew it was true, and I knew God was good, and I sang it anyway. And you know what happens? The Lord takes us, and he lifts us up out of that pit, and he sets our feet back on the rock. You can't give up. You can't throw in the towel. God is still good. You have to persevere and endure. Amen. Amen. And going home 2 weeks ago and seeing my wife laying in the bed, and I came home to the sound of a song of praise and seeing her on her bed with her Bible open, praising God for his faithfulness. Now, folks, you don't get that on the mountain. The mountain is good. Everything feels great. Every time you read the Word of God, you're getting insight. Every time you turn around, you're getting a blessing. Everybody's smiling, shaking your hand, patting you on the back. That's the mountain. You're going to come off of that mountain, and guess what? You're going to be in a valley. Right. And 3 weeks ago, Nancy said in Sunday school, she said, everybody is either in the middle of a trial, coming out of a trial, or going into a trial. And I remember Laura and I sitting there, we said, man, that's so true, but I don't like that. Because we didn't know we were getting ready to go into a trial. But the great thing is that the journey doesn't stop in the struggle. The journey stops in victory with Jesus. And there are going to be answers that you desire that you may never get a satisfying response. But we get something better than that. We get the sure, manifest presence of God in our midst. And we get a reminder. And that's what this psalm is all about. And the reason I'm preaching it is because, to be quite honest with you, it's the only thing that spoke to me in 2 weeks. So if you'll stand with me, we'll read Psalm 73. It says this, truly God is good to Israel, to such as are pure in heart. But as for me, my feet had almost stumbled. My steps had nearly slipped. For I was envious of the boastful when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. There are no pains in their death, but their strength is firm. They are not in trouble as other people. They are not plagued like other men. Therefore, pride serves as their necklace. Violence covers them like a garment. Their eyes bulge with abundance. They have more than their heart could wish for. They scoff and speak wickedly concerning oppression. They speak lawfully. They have set their mouths against heaven, and their tongue walks through the earth. Therefore, his people return here, and waters of a full cup are drained by them. And they say, how does God know? And is there knowledge in the Most High? Behold, these are the ungodly who are always at ease. They always increase in riches. Surely I have kept my heart pure in vain, and I've washed my hands in innocence. For all day long I have been plagued, and I've been chastened every morning. If I had said, I will speak this, behold, I would have been untrue to the generation of your children. When I thought how to understand this, it was too painful for me, until I went into the sanctuary of God. How many of you know it's the presence of God that changes our perspective? Then I understood their end. Surely you set them in slippery places. You cast them down to destruction. Oh, how they are brought to desolation as in a moment. They are utterly consumed with terrors as a dream when one awakes. So, Lord, when you awake, you shall despise their image. Thus my heart was grieved, and I was vexed in my mind. I was so foolish and ignorant. I was like a beast before you. Nevertheless, I am continually with you. You hold me by my right hand. You will guide me with your counsel and receive me afterwards into glory. Whom have I in heaven but you? There is none upon earth that I desired besides you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. For indeed, those who are far from you shall perish. You have destroyed all those who desert you for harlotry. But it is good for me to draw near to God. I have put my trust in the Lord, God, that I may declare your works. Let's pray. Lord, we just thank you for your word. We thank you, O God, that no matter what valley we walk through in life, we thank you that you are with us. We thank you, O God, that you are continually, you are an ever-present help in time of need. We praise you for that, O God, and we give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. I love how this verse starts off with a declaration. He says, God is good. Truly, God is good to Israel, to such that are pure in heart. And I always think about that, and I kind of took that as, you know, that moment when things are going wrong and you're questioning your faith, but you know what you should say. You know what you're supposed to say. Come on now. Are there any other human beings in the room besides me? My Christian life isn't perfect. I struggle sometimes. I go through things that I do not understand. I look around me and I see people that are being promoted. I see people who are advancing. And I wonder, God, how in the world are they being blessed? And I'm going through this junk. But I know what I'm supposed to say. God is good. All the time, and all the time, God is good. I grew up hearing that. I grew up saying that. But it's when you're in the valley that this truth, and make no mistake about it, folks, that is a statement of fact, that God is good. Being in the valley takes that knowledge from here, and it really reveals whether or not it's truly here. Because you can say all the right things. But it's what we do in the moments of adversity. It's what we do in the moments of trial. It's how we react to God when we think and when the devil will try to tell us he's abandoned you. See, I told you you were never really good enough. I told you this was all a sham. I told you you were following this path for nothing. You might as well be like everybody else and enjoy life. Does my heart say, no, God is good, truly. Truly, God is good. Because if I truly believe God is good, then there's nothing that can happen on earth that will shake that conviction. That's why I love what Paul says. Neither life, nor death, nor angels, nor demons, nothing above the earth or under the earth, truly nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. You learn that in the valley. Now it takes a sharp turn in verse 2. He says, but as for me, my feet had almost slipped. My steps had nearly slipped because I was envious of the boastful. And I think it's a natural response sometimes as human beings. When you see yourself trying to live for God and you are denying yourself certain things. But then you see other people who, oh man, they got all the money to spend. They're always shopping. They're high rolling. They're living high on the hog. And look at us. Sometimes our heart will want to say, man, I wish I could be like that for just a moment. I wish I could indulge. Wouldn't it be nice? I remember sometimes, it might have been a couple weeks ago, I said, Laura, wouldn't it be nice to just be able to wake up at church and roll over like everybody else does? But truly, when you come into the presence of God, everything changes. He was dealing with doubt in verses 2 and 3. And here's what Warren Wiersbe says about doubt. He says, when pondering the mysteries of life, hold on to what you know for sure and never doubt in the darkness what God has taught you in the light. Never doubt in the valley what God has shown you on the mountain, because it's still true. Right, Bruce? The God of the mountain is still God in the valley. Amen? The God of the day is still God of the night. There's more than just a song. That's real life. And if it hadn't been tested in you yet, friend, it will be. Whenever we doubt God's goodness, we have to remember that we give power to our doubt. It's a natural thing to doubt. It's a natural thing to question. But there's a difference in doubting God and having unbelief. There's a difference in questioning and having unbelief. There's a big difference. Because those who have unbelief are rebellious and they refuse to turn. But questioning God is simply, many times, it's just the response of an honest heart. Lord, I read in your word where you tell me you will provide all my needs, but we can't pay the bills this month. What's going on? And you want me to pay this, but I can't pay this. What am I supposed to do? That's the response of an honest heart many times. And what you'll find when you respond in obedience is that God will always be faithful, and he will always bless your obedience after the fact. If he blessed you before, then it wouldn't be taking a step of faith. He always honors and blesses obedience after we have followed through. A perfect example we saw of that was last week in this church. When Antioch Baptist Church says we're going to be faithful to send Gary to Africa. Gary said he's going to be faithful to go. We said we're going to be faithful to follow the leadership of the Holy Spirit, and we're going to follow the Lord, and we're going to put up elders in place. And last Sunday, one of our newly appointed elders came back from a missions trip, proclaimed the word of God, and the Holy Spirit showed up. We have to understand that's the stamp of God's obedience. And you always hear about the highlights of the missions trip. But many times we don't always tell you what it, you know, the nights when you're wondering. You're hearing the sounds of the lions growling outside your tent, and you're saying, oh God, I know you better protect me. We deal with doubt, but when you're in the valley, don't forget how you felt on the mountain. And I would tell you to do this. Doubt your doubt before you doubt your faith. Because God's always true. His word's always true. And my feelings don't dictate and don't change the fact that God is faithful. And that God is sovereign. God is in control. But then why do the wicked perish? Why do good people die? Why do hard times come? Well, we have to remember, and I know this. I know that it's because sin is in the world. When you're in the valley, though, sometimes that answer is just not good enough. Sometimes that cliche answer that well-meaning brother or sister gives you doesn't cut it. But you know who always knows exactly how to comfort your broken heart? It's the Holy Spirit. I just can't tell you. He knows exactly. He brings that peace, and it guards your heart and your mind, and it helps you to walk through. Asaph was looking at these wicked people, and he says, they're not in trouble like other people. They're not plagued like other men. They wear their pride as a necklace. Violence covers them. Their eyes are bulging with abundance. He's like, these people that are despising your word, that are questioning you, that are mocking you, they look like they're doing okay. They scoff and speak wickedly, constantly. Their tongue walks through the earth. Their big mouth, their loud mouth, they're always talking about what they got. Y'all know people like that? Everyone's like, yeah. Don't point across the room or anything. He's dealing with doubt in verses 2 and 3, and then he starts dealing with with discouragement and depression in 4 through 14. How is this fair? How is it fair, God? He keeps on going. Your people return here, and waters of a full cup are drained by them. They're taking away from your people. And then they mock you. They say, how does God know? Is there knowledge in the Most High? Behold, these are the ungodly, and they're always at ease. They increase in riches. And in verse 13, he says, surely I must have cleansed my heart in vain. Why am I really living this way for God? What have you done for me lately? Where are my blessings? Where is this? Where is that? And it's in the valley that you're truly tested. Is God truly enough? When everything else is stripped away, is God still more than enough for you? The testing of our faith. When life hits you like a hurricane. Surely I've cleansed my heart in vain. I've washed my hands in innocence. Why? Because in verse 14, he says, all day long I've been plagued. Everything's been going wrong. I'm chastened every morning. It doesn't matter which direction I turn or where I take a step, it seems like it's the wrong thing. We go through seasons like this. We deal with discouragement. We deal with doubt. And we have to remember, doubt comes from a struggling mind, while unbelief comes from a stubborn will that refuses to surrender to God. The unbelieving person will not believe, but the doubting person is simply struggling to understand what he knows is true, but he doesn't see. So don't feel like, I know sometimes I feel like, well, I must be a bad Christian because I'm not trusting God right now. Well, maybe you're just going through a really hard time and you're just a normal person and you're having doubt. Don't throw in the towel. Go back to the Word. Remind yourself, feed on his faithfulness, because if he was faithful before, he will be faithful again. If he comforted you before, he will comfort you again. If he pulled you up out of the pit once, he can pull you up out of the pit twice. And I know this because he's done it for me. And walking in faith means believing God despite sometimes what my reality is. Believing God despite my feelings, despite my emotions, despite my circumstances. I love verse 15 because he says this. If I had said, I will speak this, behold, I would have been untrue to the generation of your children. So here's what he does. He gets right to the moment to where he feels like he's going to burst, and he has all this frustration, and he feels like he's going to vent it, but he knows God is faithful. And so you know what he does? Instead of speaking and giving power to that doubt, what does he do? He says, I come into the sanctuary. Verse 17. It wasn't an easy journey, though. Look at verse 16. He says, when I thought how to understand this, he says, it was too painful for me. It was too painful for me. He was depressed. He was hurting until, verse 17, until I went into the sanctuary of God. Then I understood their end. And that word went into doesn't mean he just walked in the door. It means to enter in, to commune. It means that he got into God's presence. It means that he proclaimed God's promise. It means that instead of sitting or standing or staring around, he said, God, blessed be the name of the Lord. You give and you take away. You are God. He entered into the sanctuary. There's a difference in going to church and entering into the presence of God. Worlds apart. Worlds apart. The word went into literally is used in the Hebrew to describe relations between a man and a woman. It brings along the idea of there is an intimate exchange between you and God. It means that you have these doubts and questions, but you pour your heart out to him. You are honest with him. He already knows how you feel. He knows what it's like because he's walked it. But instead of giving power to that doubt, and instead of being a complainer, and instead of going around and airing all the dirty laundry, instead of digging a pit and sitting in it, I'm going into God's presence and I'm lifting up holy hands anyway. And I'm lifting you up anyway because I know that you're good. I know that you're faithful. And I'll see my babies again. God's presence brings clarity. This is what it does. God's presence lifts our focus from our circumstances to our destiny. Destined to rule and reign with Christ in heaven forever. That's why Paul writes, this momentary light, momentary affliction is nothing to be compared to the glory that will be revealed. Friends, there is a glory coming like we have never experienced on earth. There is a day coming when our soul will ascend into heaven and we will walk into eternity, into the presence of God, and you will be light as a feather. Everything that you used to be concerned with, every pain, every doubt, every struggle, every tear will be forever wiped away, never to be thought or dwelt on again. And all those wicked people, all those people who think they live in high on the hog, guess what? The bottom's going to fall out one day and none of that stuff's going to be around. You don't hear a lot about heaven and hell today. But I'm telling you, can you just imagine what it would be like without Jesus? The moment, a minute after you die, instead of your soul ascending into eternal glory, imagine your soul descending through the lower earthly regions. Imagine the realization of every opportunity that you had to turn to Christ playing back in full HD stereo. And the realization that you never get another opportunity to repent. Think about it. You know what you'll hear on that descent? I'm just telling you. I know your soul may be heavy. I know you may be walking through the valley, but God is faithful and will bring you through. Don't give up. God is good. Think about the eternal consequences as the soul of the unsaved descends and all they hear are the screams, "Let me out!" And there is no relief. I remember when I was working at the jail, we had, you know, open cells and bars, and there was a man who was, he was, I don't know if he was, what it was, what his problem was, but he was disturbed, and he would come to that gate, and he'd shake and rattle that gate, and he'd say, "Let me out, let me out, let me out." That's what hell's going to be like. Nothing to do but wait for the pronouncement of eternal judgment. The heat coming in on your soul, weighing down the soul, the thoughts, the remorse, the guilt, and no relief. That's reality. But when we come into the sanctuary of God, if we will enter into the presence, if we will enter into His forgiveness, we can have the fullness of joy. All the pain that I dealt with last week, I look forward, because you know what? A day is coming when I'll never even remember it. That's good news, isn't it? The pain, the agony that we're carrying, one day it will be completely washed away and vanished from your memory bank. God's presence shifts our perception from the external to the eternal. And many times God will use our pain as a platform to minister to others. So I can tell other people, "I know what you're going through, but listen, God is faithful. You'll make it. Weeping may last for the night, but joy comes in the morning." But you got to put on that garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. God promises to bring beauty out of ashes. I love that. His whole perception shifted. He remembered that the wicked are going to be destroyed. They're going to be consumed. He says in verse 20, as a dream when one awakes. One day it's going to wake up and it's all going to be gone. A beast before you. You know, as I sat down and I was just wondering and questioning, I started to just make myself thank God for every blessing that I had. I thank God for my wonderful wife, my beautiful children, my awesome church family that so many of you reached out and were loving and understanding. And you know what? It wasn't even 4 days later before I had to take that comfort and take it to another brother who was going through another tragedy. And that's how it works, guys. We go through the valley, but we never go through alone. And when my friends, when my brothers and sisters are going through, I remind them, don't give up down there. The story doesn't end on that bad page. God's still writing. He still holds the pen. He's got a good plan for your life. And you can't give up on that. And you've got to believe that. And you've got to hold on to that. Because giving into despair will poison your soul. Giving into the depression, I remember it just feels like you've got 1,000 pounds sitting on your chest. No reason to get up out of bed. Man, start to call out to Jesus. Start to call His name, and He'll lift you up. I love verse 23, because nevertheless, I am continually with you. That word continually, it means, another way to translate it is in perpetuity. Which, if you don't know, that means on and on and on. Aren't you glad that when we do doubt and we do question, God doesn't open up the door and kick us off the bus? Yeah. Oh, you doubted. See ya. Too late. Oh, you didn't quote that promise. Adios, amigo. No, He says, I'm continually with you. God loves us enough to walk us through our struggle. He's not going to beat you up. He's not going to tear you down. If anybody is telling you, oh, you shouldn't be feeling like that, you just need to give up, that's the devil. God is saying, oh, I'm here with you. You know, if God is wooing me and He's telling me and He's calling me to get into His word and get into His presence, and I blow Him off and I go working around the yard, you know, and I can't find something, you know what? As soon as I find it, I can see God's going to be there saying, here you go, I love you. Come spend time with me. I'm going to get halfway around the house and I'm going to see a sunrise, or I'm going to see the sun setting, and I'm going to see God. I'm going to hear God saying, I want you. Come see me. continually with us, carrying our pain. He said, I'm with you continually. You hold me by my right hand. Man, put your hand in the hand of the man that calmed the waters. Put your hand in the hand of the man that calmed the raging sea. I love this because in the Hebrew, the picture is not just grabbing by the hand, but grabbing by the forearm. You know what that tells me? When I'm too weak to hold on, God is going to reach down and make sure he's got a good grip. And let me tell you something, there is nobody that's ever slipped out of his grip. Not ever. Not once. Will never happen. Nothing can take you out of his hand. That's called assurance. We feed on his faithfulness. He says, you will guide me with your counsel. And afterwards, receive me into glory. I love that because not only, it doesn't just mean glory in heaven, it means glory now. Afterwards, I'm going to bring you back into my presence. I'm going to give you joy unspeakable and full of glory. I'm going to wipe those tears. I'm going to put a smile on your face. And I'm going to remind you how much I love you. That's the God we serve, folks. That's the God we serve. God will always comfort. God will always guide. And here we go, verse 25. He says, whom have I in heaven but you? There is none on earth that I desire besides you. That's how you truly know that you're surrendered to God, when you lose everything and he's still more than enough. What are we fretting about? What are we worried about? Sticks and mortar? Paper with old dead president's face on it? None of it's going to last. None of it's going to last forever. Let me tell you something. There is an eternal glory that is coming for us. Jesus Christ himself is going to come and receive us to himself. It should regain our perspective. We choose where we live and how we respond. You can choose to stay and keep your house in this valley. The choice is yours. Life's going to be tough. It's going to be hard. You're going to have bumps and bruises and skid knees all the way. We will have trials and tribulations. We will experience hardship. But Jesus said this, take heart. I have overcome the world. The great thing about walking with Jesus is that you may live in the valley for a while, but guess what? He's going to lift you out and set you on top of the rock. But you choose where you live. Where are you choosing to build your house this morning? You choose to either live in victory or to be a victim. You choose to either accept the deliverance of God or to wallow in despair. He says this, my flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. God is the strength. The word is literally rock. So guess what? You get up out of the valley, he puts you on top of the rock, a firm foundation, secure footing, so that nothing in life can knock you down forever. If it does knock you down, guess what? It's going to knock you right into him. And he's going to be with you until you get back up. I want you to get up out of that pit today. Don't stay in the valley. You may be walking through the valley of the shadow of death, but you know what? You can still have peace and joy in your heart. And I'm telling you from experience, I didn't read it out of a book. I've lived it for the last month and a half. My flesh and heart did fail, but you know what? God was the strength of my heart. He was my portion forever. He is my portion. He's my possession. He's my inheritance. No matter what I lose on earth, it's nothing compared to what I will gain in eternity. You believe that this morning? The trial will reveal it. The valley will reveal it. If you truly believe it, it will come out in the valley. For indeed, those who are far from you shall perish. You have destroyed all those who desert you for harlotry. But it is good for me to draw near to God. I have put my trust in the Lord that I may declare all your works. The thing I love about Asaph is that he still got up in the sanctuary and he still led the people in worship. He still got up and did what God told him to do. He didn't let the valley keep him from proclaiming the praises of God, and neither can you. Psalm 73 presents an intriguing approach to reality. The whole problem underlying the psalm comes out of a realistic and frank appraisal of the claim made for God. His human experience was contrary to that claim that God was good. But the psalm does not limit reality to human experience and human rationality. Aren't you glad that it goes past our experience, it goes past our rationale, and it goes straight into the faithfulness of God? The Bible is the realest book that was ever written. You don't think the saints doubted? You don't think the saints went through struggles? Read the book. Abraham had Isaac, the promise, on the altar, and God told him to raise the knife. But God was faithful and brought a ram. Come on, somebody. Joseph saw a dream of people bowing down to him, and he was thrown in prison for a crime he didn't even commit. But what happened? He went from the prison to the palace. Why? Because he never doubted God's goodness for long. He knew God was faithful. Come on now, Christian. God is the strength of your heart and your portion forever. Your heart and flesh may fail, but my God never will. Amen. I want the worship team to come. I invite you, whenever you lay out God's word and God's promises to test whether they're true or not, if you will hang in there, you will find out 100 times out of 100 that God is true and his word is good. And he is faithful. Draw near to God this morning. It's good for you to draw near to God. When you're going through the trial, when you're living in the valley, when you're going through hardship, it is good for you to draw near to God in that moment. Jesus Christ right now is at the right hand of the Father, praying you through it. He ever lives to make intercession for us. He loves us. He gave his life for us. He is ready and willing to dry your tears and to give you the next step. He will guide you and give you his counsel. Don't let your trust in God be shaken. Draw near to him, come near to him, and keep your trust in him secure. Believe beyond the shadow of a doubt. Trust in God. He's never failed. His word's always true. And the third step is this. When you go out today, no matter what valley you're living in, declare with your mouth the goodness and the praises of God. Because when you proclaim God's word hard enough and long enough, your heart and flesh will revive by the Holy Spirit and will get in line. But you got to say it. You know why? Because it's always true. No matter what you feel, no matter what you see, God is the strength of your heart. If you're here this morning and you're living in the valley, as we sing this song that reminds us of God's faithfulness and God's goodness, I invite you to come. We'd love to pray for you. We're going to sing one last song like we do every week. If you need to respond, you need to come. Come. And if you don't know Jesus, I don't want your soul to burn in hell forever. If you don't know Jesus, I want you to know about the truth that can set you free. Don't take another moment for granted. You don't know what will happen 10 minutes from now, much less 10 years from now. Do not walk out on God. If you need Jesus this morning, come and receive him. And you know what? You get all of those promises so that when your life is in this, you get lifted up to heaven too. Because without Jesus, the valley is going to seem good compared to hell. I can tell you 100%, people in hell will be screaming out for their worst time on earth. That's a fact. And the truth is this, God made a way so you don't have to go there. And he will be with you forever, continually with you, no matter what you go through in life. And maybe you're too weak to hold on to his hand, don't worry. He'll take a hold of you and he'll lift you up. As we stand and sing, if you need to come and respond today, we'd love to pray for you. Let's stand and sing How Great the Father's Love.
To make a rest.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. When you have your eyes set on Jesus, you always remember, no matter how often you walking through the valley, you remind yourself, I'm just passing through. Amen? That's not where the story ends. Amen. Can we give the Lord praise for that? God is good. Amen. Praise God. Our sisters, Sharon, Kathy, and Jessica, they want to be baptized into the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Next Sunday, praise God, at 17. Where you at? Gary and Dwayne both said it's 14. That's all we've got so far. And hey, if you've never been baptized by water, if you've never been baptized into the name of Jesus Christ like that, showed that obedience, hey, we're going to be down by the river next week. No time like the present. Amen? Amen. Praise God. Let me pray over you. Lord, I just pray over your people. I thank you, oh God, that the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. I thank you, oh Lord, that you don't kick us out of the club when we question. Lord, you remind us of your faithfulness in so many ways, through so many people, through your word, by the presence of your Holy Spirit. Lord, I just pray as we walk out, Lord, there may be people here. They're going to step out of your sanctuary, and that problem's going to be right there at the door. Give them new perspective, God. Bring healing to their hearts in Jesus' name. Give them boldness, oh God. Fill them with joy and with your peace and with your love to know if God is for them, who can be against them? Nothing can stand between you and your people. You love us with an everlasting love. You loved us enough to prove it by giving your life. Nothing is going to keep you from possessing your people. We thank you, oh God. We just pray that as we will go in faith, that we will go in hope, and we will go in love. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you. Go in the peace and joy of the Lord. See you Thursday night. No words, no phrase I could